I first started back when I was in high school. We had a sugar bush down on the lower end of this road. And then in 75, we started tapping full time. This is the best year we've ever had this year. We sell it down in a little building down the road.
So we have a full commercial operation, and then we're doing research within various windows of that operation. And then my other role is that I get to work with the industry and doing a lot of outreach and education, sharing kind of the research that we do.
And you know, the kids always love doing maple sugaring. They learn the whole process of maple sugaring itself too. So we tap all the trees, we set up the buckets.
I've learned a lot about maple sugaring, how to do it, basically how it's done. I've learned a lot of history too with the research I've had to do for projects. And I learned also how to identify plenty of trees, which helps with the maple sugaring.
I think the more I can get kids outside, the more they realize how much they like being outdoors, and they actually, without even meaning to, they learn more because they're more interested. You're in the fresh air, and they're actually seeing real life scenarios where this stuff's applied. There's a little science behind it with the evaporation and the sugar measurement. We use the hydrometer to test the sugar content and see when we're actually at syrup, like a real professional would do. The filtering and canning process, so they get the whole start to finish maple sugaring process. We have a very small scale operation with the 7 buckets, and we produce about a little over a quart, almost 2 quarts of syrup.
And we all got to like kind of see how the maple was forming and how maple sugaring works.
New York State actually has the most amount of tappable maple trees. It's been growing in New York State. We're growing on average at least 5% typically every year.
You need very specific temperatures to get a run, they call it. So that's when sap's flowing out of the tree.
When the atmospheric temperature dips to freezing, there's actually a negative pressure created within the trees. And that allows the trees to pull in groundwater into the roots, travel up to the roots and the trunk and into the branches. And while it's doing that, that groundwater is picking up all of the stored sugars, and that's our maple sap.
The maple trees specifically have, for whatever reason, a higher sugar content. Just when the nutrients they have stored in there, they turn the carbohydrates and they use that as the sugars.
Within the Adirondacks, especially, you know, we get those good long winters. Typically, we have the nice long gradual thaw, and then we have great maple forests as well. But if we look at, you know, what's really important for that sap flow is that freeze-thaw cycle. So weather and the climate is really important. 2021 was a poor maple production season. It was a season that ended sooner, so production was definitely down. And when it ended, the quality went down because we hit some really high temperatures. And so once you hit high temperatures, it's hard to keep that sap from spoiling and making off-flavored syrup.
The season started earlier for us here. It was more like middle of February, which usually you see it towards the end of February.
This year we started a little earlier than usual because the month of February was warmer. We had a cold snap and it didn't go for well, you know, so it was a while before we boiled, but we had everything was froze up, so it stays pretty fresh when it's that way.
There's gonna be huge changes coming up in the future. Eventually you're gonna see the range where you can do maple sugaring, it's gonna start working its way farther north because you'll have the right temperature. It's so temperature specific that this temperature change is gonna greatly affect the maple sugaring process itself.
Yeah, it's hard to pinpoint, you know, directly to climate change and looking at maple production, how that's really impacting it, because maple trees are very kind of slow to respond. But our big thing right now is trying to focus on adapting to the different climate variables, the different changes in weather. And so a lot of the research that we do here is looking at ways that we make sure that those tap holes, that when we put them in, are gonna give us the best production. You know, and maple is a great product in that we're tapping and we're collecting sap from these native kind of ecosystems, that these are habitats that are also wildlife habitats, and They're also sequestering carbon, they're helping to, you know, create purified water and filter our air and everything like that. So there's a lot of ecosystem services that maple forests provide, but within the industry, if we can continue to make sure that we reduce that energy use, so using reverse osmosis, more efficient evaporators, and thinking about our energy inputs, but then having actively healthy growing forest, that we can be a carbon sink instead of a carbon source. And so maple, in a way, can be kind of part of that solution.
Still good? All right.